Everybody, welcome back to Free Your Mind Fridays.
Let's get liberated.
Hey, it's Julie here and
Leilani.
Welcome, y'all. We're happy to see another month full of abundance. It's October. I'm really ready for the fall time. How about you, Lay?
I needed this fall. I've been looking forward to this season just because summer was so busy for me and I was just out and about in the sun having fun every weekend.
Yes.
And
Yes.
it tis the season to prepare for hibernation and
Right.
tis the season for letting go and shedding things that will make space for new growth and new blessings.
Yes, absolutely. Ooh. I love talking about fall, but unfortunately, maybe we could do another video on that. But today, we're going to be getting into something a little close to our hearts, and it's about a wellness-centered working culture.
Yes, living in a capitalist society, sometimes having to work and get our hustle on is just unavoidable. It's just become part of our daily lives. And sometimes it gets super tiring. And for a lot of people in the movement that we work in, and social justice movements, and a lot of industries, actually, not even just like the nonprofit and social justice movement, but corporate sectors, service industries, health or whatever it is. Burnout is so common. So common.
Yeah, I feel like we also like know a few things about the burnout and that feeling. And really, I feel like the piece following a wellness-centered working culture wouldn't have happened without Lay here to really put it into motion and to really care about us and just our work and our human being energy so we could like bring it to the table and really do amazing work.
I love y'all, girl.
Yes, and the feeling is so mutual, definitely times 10 always. So with that, let's talk about a little bit of how we became, and maybe I would want to volunteer you first, Lay, of just like creating the life work balance and really putting that on a pedestal, just because I know both you and I have been working since we were youngins. So I really am interested to hear about, how it came about.
Yes, I've been working for so long since I could remember, since I was probably in middle school. My mom, she worked full time, but she was a single mother. So she was also an entrepreneur and would run her own businesses. And she would pay me and my brother to help her work her weddings. And at one point, she would try to do like the flower arrangement. She would try to be a wedding planner and the florist and the caretaker for the kids section and just all these things. And so I came up just working a lot, even by the time I was 16. As soon as I could get my work permit, I started working as many jobs as possible, doing, what is it, babysitting services. So I've always worked, and even at a young age, like I had to help my family pay the bills at home and pay rent and whatnot. And so it's been ingrained in me, this kind of hustle on the grind all the time mentality, as just part of survival and just a part of life. But at a certain point, I started to only devote my working life to jobs that I actually enjoyed and was passionate about and actually cared about. And so there was this another added level of commitment, you know, like on top of my need to work in order to make money and survive and pay my bills, there was like this, you know, just this heavier sense of devotion to what I do. And so even when I started Bay Peace, you know, I just hella in love, I felt hella in love with this work through and through. And I would just overextend myself. You know, I would be working and running programs all day. And then afterward, I would go home and work on grant proposals because I knew we needed to raise money. And, you know, I would be wanting to go to the community events at night times and weekends and all of this while I had kids
Going,
and like a whole
wow,
ass
on
family.
top of that too. That's
Yeah. And even when I just first started Bay Peace, you know, like I wasn't making a lot of money. So I had another job where I was facilitating circles and doing art productions in the city. And I was in school to get my master's at the same time. And then I started my own org, Wage Art, and gosh, it just got so crazy. And I think, you know, at a certain point, my work became an escape for all of the challenges and the struggles I was having at home. And so finally, I had, you know, this kind of breakdown in 2018 and all of the things that I was going through personally, and, you know, the weight of work, I think just all came crashing down on me, all compounded on top of one another. And I always say I reframe how I think about that moment and how I talk about that moment in 2018 as more of a breakthrough instead of a breakdown, because it was at that point that I realized things had to change, like not only my mindset and the ways that I think about and approach my commitment to work and my personal life, but also having to like recondition myself and my habits and like my daily practices to make sure that that didn't happen again. Because wow, that moment, it was just so life-changing, not just for me, but for my kids too. And so ever since then, I've been on this really deep, intentional journey to cultivate my own wellness in my own life. And you know, I've been super obsessed with the eight dimensions of wellness, which I'm happy to get into. I don't know if, I don't think we had an episode on that, but the eight dimensions of wellness is like all of the dimensions in our lives. It was coined by the Substance Abuse and Health Services, or what is it? Substance Abuse and Health Services Administration. They coined these eight dimensions, and then, you know, we at Bay Peace, we expanded it to include two additional. So now we think about it as like these 10 dimensions. And so as I've been on this personal journey and deeper commitment towards cultivating wellness in my own life, I've also realized how important it is to cultivate wellness centered in our workplace and like help y'all and help my allies and, you know, close loved ones also cultivate them this for themselves. But you know, it's sometimes it could start on an individual and a personal level, but when we are able to create conditions that even allow for individuals to attend to their personal wellness, it makes it so much more easier for them. And so I've also been really intentional about integrating more wellness-centered systems and processes and protocols within our organization. And so you know, I'm happy I've been able to include you in that journey.
Yes, definitely. And I really feel it's needed. Just because we do so much work. Even when you were listing all the things that you said that you used to do all at once, those are huge core things for our organization, you know? And I think with the wellness-centered working culture is on your brain, I think it just allows us to do that work. But even more strategically and just a little more passion and energy to it. And I feel like that has helped me a lot joining Bay Peace and everything. And Same as you, Lay. I was working super young and I believe I started my first official job at 16 when I was like on the payroll and everything. And it was a grocery store. And if anybody who has really worked at a grocery store, you know, that's where you learn a lot of things, a lot of rushing and multitasking and customer service. And I feel like it was a really, really good job for me at the time. And as time continued, I just always felt like I had to overwork myself in order to get noticed or in order to get claps from my family or something, just because my dad and my grandpa, they grew up in a different kind of time, you know? So they always just implanted that you need to work, like you need to work your ass off if you want to get somewhere. And that could be true in some cases. But, and I'll get into the little, I'll get into it when we're talking about like the myths and everything. But as a young woman, that absolutely did not get me anywhere. I was working for jobs that didn't value uplifting their employees or promoting them or anything. And with that, I felt like what we have at Bay Peace is totally different from the jobs I once had, because Bay Peace always focuses on the leadership and upliftment of youth. And so I just feel like with even that value, it implants something into one's head that they can be good enough without overworking themselves. And that's when my mind started to shift with Bay Peace of course, I'm always still going to have multiple jobs at once. I think that's just because where we live and just how we grew up, of course, but not at the cost of my health and my wellness. I really started ever since I was a youngin, when I was working at those other jobs, there was multiple ages there. And what people don't know a lot is when you're a child working, older people could really overstep their boundaries with you and like belittle you a little bit, you know, if you don't meet the qualifications that they want you to meet. And I know that you feel the same way. It's just like there's boundaries within workspaces and you have to upkeep them. And also, there's the same thing as like equity and equality that we still feel like we have to think about. And just at those other corporations, I didn't get anything like that. So working with Bay Peace really has helped me learn to say no when needed. Even just express my feelings and not as like a blown up way, you know, like I've done with other jobs. Like I think the wellness-centered working culture is really a pedestal just to show up as yourself and be comfortable enough, but also be comfortable enough to receive like feedback and help. You know, that's a huge one. And I think it just speaks volumes to our work and what we do and how we show up and how we talk to people. And when that's not being met, the work is gonna be like, eh, you know, those bosses are gonna know when their employees are going down south, you know. And I really have just enjoyed working on my wellness. And when I was young, I used to always pray for a job that I first enjoyed, that something I really loved to do. Second was dress however I would like. And third was really just a place where I can be myself and show up as myself. And I feel like the gods have answered. They've been answered my prayer when I joined Bay Peace full time.
Yeah, so much to unpack there.
So much.
Yeah, I mean, I at a certain point, I just realized that, like you said, there's so much that we do for the community and in service of youth and others. You know what I mean? Like, so in a lot of ways, the work that we do is not about us, but how can we expect ourselves and for me as a director, like how can I expect my team to show up and show out for everybody else when we're not taking care of ourselves first? And so the better we take care of ourselves, the better we can do in showing up for others. And it's true, like we live in a capitalist society, and it's also we have similar experiences of it being a part of like all the culture in our families of working hard. And don't get me wrong, I'm a hard worker. I'm very committed and very intentional about wanting to do good work. And at the same time, I've realized how much more productive and how much more powerful my energy is and my work output is when I'm kind of moving with ease, and I'm making things simpler for myself. And I've noticed that about us too. And
Absolutely.
so seeing how we did when we were doing so much work, like events every single month, and then coming down to more like two events a year, it was so much like it was so necessary. But we should get into the myths, because I think you started to touch on it, and you started to touch on some tips too, just both on the personal and organizational level, like what you do in your daily practice and what we do as an organization. But one of the things that you mentioned that really stood out to me as sort of a myth is that our value as humans is associated with productivity. And I think that's something a lot of people believe, that in order to be valued, in order to matter, we have to do something. And we have to, we have to, it our value is associated with like our success or our accomplishments or these things that you can tangibly see on a checklist. And that's not true. The truth is, in my opinion, that we as humans living, existing, where we us living, it's enough for us to matter. You know what I mean? Like
No,
all
absolutely.
humans, it's one of our core values. Like all humans deserve dignity, regardless of
Absolutely.
the situation.
And I feel like sometimes I wish to go back to like my younger self that was like breaking her back just to do all these things and not just to get money, but also just to get validation. And I really just want to tell her, like, we are not our job titles, girl. We are not our descriptions. We're real people with real characteristics outside of our work. We have passions outside of our work and really uplift those passions as well, you know? And I know we have to sometimes really grind for, our money, but we are not those job titles. We are not those job titles.
And I think too, at least for me, it's also very personal. Like I grew up not feeling very seen and not feeling very affirmed or being very affirmed by my loved ones, and like low key neglected, or like especially emotionally, and even having a single mother, like she wasn't home a lot. And so growing up, I never experienced that sense of validation or affirmation, like I just matter and I just deserve love and presence simply because I was born and I exist. And so, that also evolved into like people pleasing tendencies, and that kind of seeps into how we show up at work. And so a lot of it is also like reconditioning ourselves, and at least for me, being able to unpack, how I associate my own personal sense of value and self-worth, and how that's been influenced by the things that I've went through in as a child, and learning to just reaffirm my existence regardless and honoring myself regardless.
Yes, period. Someone quote her. Oh. No, but seriously, yes. And while we're talking about myths too, something I feel like you've also touched on too is one of my myths that I wrote down is always being accessible to either your supervisor or your job in your case. Like 24/7. Like who said we need to do that?
Yeah, and just
Who
anybody too.
imprinted that into our mind, thinking that we need to be accessible to our boss, our job, 24/7? Yeah, and it's really with anybody too. We should just popcorn and see myths, myths, myths.
I only have one more that I can think of. And my second myth is that balance means equal. I think, when you have this, what's that instrument called, where like you see if it's equal, the weight is equal on both sides. It's kind of like a seesaw, but what's that called?
I don't know.
What is that thing called? But anyways, okay, so the myth is that balance means equal. And the truth is, I think when it comes to this idea of a work-life balance, sometimes our lives, our personal lives, and our personal self, like just maybe it's our mental health or our physical health or whatever it is, they just require more attention, and more energy and care. And then sometimes there are moments where there's urgency in our work, you know what I mean? And we have like certain deadlines, or like when I came back from sabbatical, and that very same day it was like a grant proposal due. So I was like, oh shit, I gotta like get into the zone and do this because I know we need this money. And so I think instead of imagining a work-life balance as things always have to be equal, it's understanding and being attuned to your flow and being attuned to like what your personal needs are, and like having a sense of, okay, this is a time for me and this is a time for work. And even last time when we did the recording, I was so tired that day. I don't know what was going on, but I remember I was working in bed all day.
A
I
little
was
background,
like,
y'all.
I cannot be up and about. I don't even want to sit at a desk. I need to be able to just like lay back and relax and do my writing and take my calls. And I was able to do it in bed. And thank goodness we have the flexibility of being able to work from home, that I was able to do that. But yeah, so not thinking about things as equal, but just thinking about things as like a flow, and as like a wave, and sometimes it goes up and sometimes it goes down, sometimes attention is here, sometimes urgency is there, and just being attuned to that and kind of going with it, you know what I mean?
Yes, absolutely. You're making me think about another myth that I put down was I have it written down here somewhere. Was if oh if the job inputs your wellness-centered working lifestyle or culture, that a myth that I found out was some people think like it might make the employees lazier or just not pulling their own weight as much as if someone had a lot of authority on them. And I feel like it kind of goes hand in hand with what you said, Lay, just was sometimes it's not totally just blank, a straight line. Sometimes we do have to have those rest periods. And then we have to sometimes have a bigger, working week or something. But I believe the more time we talk about wellness and we put wellness on top of our minds, we can be able to do those things willingly. You know what I'm saying? There's sometimes we'll have a quiet month in the nonprofit world where we're just taking heck of meetings and everything like that. And then there's one month that like we gotta be out in community like every week. And like you said, it's not just a straight line. It's not just equal at that instrument. It's waves all the time. But you really have to listen to yourself and also your team as well.
There's a sense of like attentiveness that we have to have for ourselves and the work, and like really mindfulness so that we are able to be attuned with what are our needs or what are the needs of our work. You know, sometimes we even have to exercise our practice of foresight, you know, so if we know we're going to be hella busy in the spring. Okay, let's make sure we anticipate right after that we take a good rest period, you know what I mean? Or, you know, in the summer, right after the summer, you know, during summer, we're able to kind of keep it chill a little bit before it starts to pick up. So yeah, those are the myths that I had. Do you feel ready to dig into some tips and tricks?
I did want to mention one last myth that I feel like Babies has really overcame, and personally me figuring out I could probably do this is a myth I feel like is always kind of being thrown around in the workplace, is that taboo feeling of asking for a raise or extra funds, or even like when you've been working at a place for like a year, you get like your little cola raise and stuff. I just feel like that if you have a wellness culture working wait, but I have to edit this because I totally just blanked. If your work has a wellness base within your job, I feel like that space is there for you, and you can ask your boss or your supervisor, anybody who you want to talk to about your raises. Because one thing that Leigh and I have said is when we were younger, we've developed all these skills now that I don't know how you feel, Leigh, but I feel like any job I'll have, I know how to do them with the right training. And I could just really hop in there and work just because I've been working since I was a teenager. And when you have the ability to help out your business or your job or whichever, you're an asset, and I don't think we should feel like we're not. And so I feel like the raises and the extra funds, asking for that is key, like it's key for your wellness as well. Just so you could be getting paid, or just even putting it out there in the universe that, you deserve a little extra something, especially if you've been like working your butt off.
Yeah, I get a lot of I get a lot of like newsletter emails 'cause I'm subscribed to like a lot of different wellness platforms, and I had seen one I think yesterday, and it was like I don't know if it was from LinkedIn, maybe it was from LinkedIn, but it was talking about the same topic, and it was saying how, you know, some companies they won't be willing to like give raises or compensate, you know, additional funds, like, you know, how we have like our wellness stipend. And it was saying companies would be like, oh no, go try yoga. But it's
Yeah.
so true because without a doubt, being able to make enough money is critical to our survival. Being able to put food in our mouths, being able to put a roof over our head, being able to afford, clothing, shelter, whatever, the transportation. And so financial wellness is definitely key, and it's something that I struggled with a lot organizationally, because as you know, we're a small nonprofit, and like I have to work my ass off for all of the grants and figure out how we're gonna make all of our money. And of course, I want to be able to pay everyone well, and I sometimes opportunities are limited, but I gotta like go out there and hustle and keep my mind open and be ready and ready to receive all the blessings that we could send forward.
Yes, and me being new to Bay Peace and everything, I remember when Lay and I were having this conversation, you're the one who told me, well, you have to advocate yourself because you wouldn't be where you are right now without advocating for yourself. And I think that's just, we could go into the, little tips and tricks now, but it's just advocating for yourself. And don't be afraid to do so because you are an asset. You're not just like this random person doing this work. You are an asset to whatever company that you're working for. And when it's right, you could really advocate for yourself. And we should as humans.
Yeah, absolutely. So, we're about halfway through our episode. Let's go ahead and start digging into some tips and tricks. Pull out your notebooks, people,
Yes.
or start your little notes app.
Whatever, y'all. Write it down. Pause it. Go get a book. Go get some tea because we about to give you some stars right now.
Yes, let's get into it. We got a lot. I got a lot.
Okay, you go first, like, because I know you do have a lot.
I got a lot. But yeah, I mean, the very first one that I have is like to eat breakfast, like your most important meal of the day, and eat a good breakfast, like not just not
Yes.
at the very least have some fruit at the
Right.
very,
And
very
water.
least some fruit and
Have some
water.
water,
Yes,
please.
like stay hydrated, but like nourish your body. Breakfast is the most important meal of the day, and those carbs and those nutrients, they carry you throughout the day. But even beyond breakfast, like I know there are a lot of people, they'll be hungry and then they'll just not eat. Like they'll feel hungry and they'll say they're hungry and they just won't eat because
And then they get hangry.
they get hangry, and for
And then we
whatever
gotta.
reason, they wait hella long to eat, and then they over here throwing attitude. And so that's
It's
another
not
one I'm
fair
gonna
to
add, is like
you.
know your cues.
Another.
Okay, so yes,
Yes.
eat your breakfast, people, drink your water, and when you feel yourself getting hungry, go eat, y'all, and eat more plants. Eat more
Yes.
plants.
Even just foods that give you energy as well too, it could really go hand in hand, y'all. Because I know if you're conscious and you're aware of your body and you eat something and you feel like shit afterwards, like no. If you know you have a big day, just don't eat that. Eat
Right.
that
Right.
thing
Like, okay, granted,
after
I
work.
love me some dessert. Like, I always got after dinner, I will always have room for dessert. And so after dinner is a time where I'm like, okay, I'm gonna treat myself to dessert. I'm just gonna go to sleep anyways. But like, don't eat
Yeah.
junk all freaking day.
No,
Definitely
especially
treat
like,
yourself.
right, exactly. Okay,
Yeah,
I'm
and
gonna.
I'm anti-restrictive dieting
Right, me
because
too.
I'm very anti-restrictive dieting. Instead of saying like, I'm not gonna do this, I'm not gonna do this, I'm not gonna do this. Me, I encourage people to think more about what you should do. So instead of being
Yes.
like, oh, I'm not gonna eat junk food, I'm like, I'm just gonna eat more
I'm gonna
plants,
eat it later.
or yeah, or I'm only gonna eat it after dinner or something. You know what
Yeah.
I mean?
I'll eat it this weekend.
Yes.
Just to really just to show up like as your best self, feeling good as well too.
Yeah, it makes a difference.
Okay, so hopping back and forth, my personal is before work and after work, sometimes it's just like non-negotiable for me just to have that time for myself. Sometimes in the mornings, I'll just like, if y'all are texting me or something, I'll text back just real quick. But after work, I feel like it's just a non-negotiable time for me just because after work, I'm chilling, I'm at home, or I'm either with a loved one. And one of my values personally is just to spend time with my loved ones and not be on my phone because first, I've already gave my time to y'all, my coworkers. After that, I just want to spend time with the people I love and they deserve my undivided attention. You know what I'm saying? So I feel like having non-negotiables for your day or for your hours or whatever, I feel like is such a key thing to include. And that's how you'll stay disciplined of like, oh my gosh, should I text them back? Like, no, like you already said this is the hour for your non-negotiable or your lunch break. You already said it out there. So though that's one of my key ones.
Yeah, and I think connect to that to non-negotiables is exercising your boundaries and upholding your boundaries for sure. Being willing to unplug from work is so necessary, and having that time for yourself is kind of connected to another one that I've been really intentional about and super disciplined about is having a daily wellness practice that I've ritualized. And with this, I think it's really important for people as they're becoming more devoted to developing a daily wellness practice for themselves. I've told you, Sin and Sam, to all do this, but to basically take inventory of all of the things that you can do that fulfill you. Whether it's journaling, dancing, going on a walk, making a yummy, nutritious smoothie or whatever it is, but taking inventory of all those things and really noticing which of the ones have the greatest impact on your stability. You know that if you don't eat well, oh shit, surge again. And so for me, my daily wellness practices, I'll make sure I have something I do in the morning, something I do at night. And no matter what, these are gonna be the things, I do in the AM and the PM, and I'm doing them daily. And even if they don't look the same every single day, like sometimes I'll meditate, sometimes I'll journal, sometimes I'll read, sometimes it'll be as simple as like giving myself a little massage or whatever it is, but I'm making sure I'm doing something every single day in the morning and before I go to bed, right after I wake up and right before I go to sleep. That's just that time for myself.
Yes. I love that too, just because when you have your own routine and what fulfills you, oh my gosh, it's like the best feeling ever, maybe showing up to work, you know? Like, I feel like when our team does it, we're just lighter and we're like, hey, what's up?
Right. Yeah, I notice when I
And
don't do it, I get more irritable.
yeah, me too. I get a lot of like anxiety. I don't know why, but that's just something that how it shows up to me. Yes, I love that. And with that, I actually started creating my own routine. When I either work from home or work in the office, is first taking my lunches. Okay, taking my lunches. And second is I love to get out of the office or like go outside or something. Even when I'm working from home, I just love being somewhere that I have not been working at just so I can get like back in the world.
Yeah, like or like a it's a good reset.
Yes, definitely. Like, it is so key to just get some fresh air when I'm on my lunchtime. And after work as well. I actually started going to the gym after work, and that was just, I feel like, a huge, and just let all the listeners know, I am not a gym girly at all, but just getting somewhere, a different setting that isn't my workspace, was just so key to me.
Yeah, so take your breaks, people. Get some sun, get some fresh air, do something
Yes.
for yourself to reset in the middle of the day or the end of the day.
Yes.
Something.
Something.
Yeah, I know when the work feels urgent, it's so easy to be like, no, I just gotta do this. I gotta do this. But it's so
No.
necessary, so necessary.
Like, go ahead, time yourself, but get outside. Go shake, do a little shakeout or something, do a little stretch.
Yes, and with that, with like taking your breaks, I also think like using your PTO, like
Yeah.
use your vacation time, use your sick
Okay.
time, like all
Yeah.
that, use your time.
Yeah.
But even then, you know, sometimes our weekends, at least for me, I used to fill up my weekends with socializing or, you know, going out with the family or being out and about, and even that sometimes can be draining and take a lot of energy. So another tip or trick that I have is to take a rest day. Like take a day to just be lazy and to just chill. I call it ripening time, you know, ripening time. So Sin, I think Sin told me at one point that her friend called it time to rot, but like I don't want to rot. So
I said that.
like if
No,
you
I
do it
told
too
them
long,
that.
oh, was that you? If you do it
I
for too
told them
long, then you start to rot, right? But if you do it for just the right amount of time, it's like you're ripening. It's like when you leave fruit out for way too long, then it starts to rot.
you're
But if you
ripening,
leave
and
it,
then it gets
if you
sweeter
leave
and
it
juicy.
ju exactly, if you leave it for just the right amount of time, it'll be ripe
That's
and it'll be
wait,
sweet
that's
and it'll be
cute.
perfectly digestible. You know what I mean? But if it's
That's
too
so
much, if
funny.
you sit too long, then
Yeah.
you know what I mean? It's like if you sleep too
Yeah.
long over your sleep cycles, then you're just still
Then
gonna
you're
feel
gonna be
tired.
crazy. Yes, no, there's definitely, Sin and I created the rotting session for when it's really like, I definitely had a rotting session after like many events all at once. You feel me? Like, I just need to sit there and freaking rot real quick. But those little days or those little moments, I love the ripening term for that. I definitely feel that day. And then even if it's like, I noticed for myself on busy weekends, you know, I could only afford maybe like an hour or two, you know? And I sometimes, you know, well, we're so stuck with our schedule. This is another little tip, but just like be gentle with yourself, you know? Like, it's okay. Things will get done. You don't have to beat yourself up over it if you don't get something done within the time that you want to.
Right,
But
like take
loosening
it easy.
delays, like, yeah, like give yourself a little ripening, a little ripening session, and you're fully in control of just doing the things that you wanna do. But you just need those times to be able to do that.
Yeah, and I think that's a myth too, is sometimes people look at like laying down and resting as being lazy, and it's not.
Right.
Like being at rest and you know, stillness is just as productive in my opinion as like the actual work itself, because you're allowing yourself time to recharge. It's like a phone,
Yeah.
right? Like if you're continuously using your phone while it's charging, then it's not going to be able to fully
It's not gonna
charge
charge.
as quick.
Duh.
So, you know, it's similar for us, I think.
Ooh, y'all better still be taking notes because reading is sometimes for real.
Yeah, we got plenty more. I think one thing that I thought of that I kind of added to my list is to know your cues. And it's really about knowing your cues of like when you're starting to get irritable or
Yes.
cranky, or You know, like listen, learning to listen to your body and be attentive to your, like how what you're doing is influencing your attitude or the ways that you're thinking, or like, you know, you were saying, sometimes when you don't do your rituals, you start to get anxiety, but knowing and being able to identify what those things are and like, okay, listening to those cues, like, okay, this is happening now. Okay, now I know I need to go do this thing, or else it's
Yes.
gonna be bad for me and it's gonna be bad for y'all.
Yes, you're making me think of, for those who don't know, we used to have Free Your Mind Fridays on our IG Lives on Baby Peace's Instagram. It's at Baby Peace 510 if y'all are interested. But I remember we did an episode about like our toolkit or something like that. Does that sound familiar there? Yeah, and I even think that's a good little tip, is like having your toolkit for when you get irritated. Because I know like everything can't be smooth sailing, okay? Like life and work just be throwing crazy things to you. But maybe, yeah, the toolkit is like some wellness little activities or actions you can take to regulate your nervous system.
Similar to that inventory, right? Like being to take inventory, being
Yes.
able to take that inventory, or building out your toolkit. And like these are the things that you know will be your fix when,
Right.
you know, you're going through whatever it is you're going through that is not healthy for you. And giving yourself those things and actually using them, you know, don't like dust some things off. Make sure you're putting it into practice.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm gonna start talking about a couple of practices that just have helped boost my productivity with work. I think so far we've
Absolutely.
talked a lot more about just wellness in general and you know, being how, you know, how our personal well-being and our personal wellness, it influences how we show up at work, of course. So that's really important. Like that's first and foremost, like just taking care of you for you. But now I'm going to talk about like taking certain steps and tricks to just boost productivity. And I think when I've started to integrate these things, it's just made I've how do I say this? My productivity has increased so much more with a lot less effort. You know what I mean? Like it comes a lot easier for me to do great work when I've done these things and integrated these practices. So the first thing that I started doing that really helped me is to build out, you know, how I have a daily ritual. I also have like a weekly and a daily and a monthly productivity practice. It's like basically a planning practice. Every month, I take a look at what are my goals or my intentions for this month. You know, what are the affirmations that I'm going to meditate on all month for these two moon cycles? For the week, I look at what are all of my priorities for this week, whether it's personal, whether it's work related, whether it's for my home and my family. So I have this really big picture view of all that I know I need to do. And then even daily, like I only set 3 to 4, sometimes 5, depending on how long these things take, 3 to 5 work priorities on any given day. For me in particular, a lot of my tasks are really big. You know, I have a lot of different projects that I'm juggling, and a lot of the things that I do, they can't really be done in like one sitting, or I would have to devote a lot of hours to it. And so it's hard for me to like be focused and zoned in on like one thing for a too long time. So I only max out on 3 to 5 priorities a day, and I'm making sure I take time every day, every week, every month to kind of look at my priorities and just help myself plan and get a vision on it. And so, you know, having my calendar and my planner and these lists, it really helps me stay organized.
Yes, I used to be so freaking crazy with my planner, y'all. And not until recently, I just finally came to terms and I was just like, goodness gracious, like, why am I psycho right now? Like, okay, you have your task, but you don't need to plan your whole entire day on Sunday for the whole entire rest of the week and weekend. And similar to you, Lay, I have all of my tasks on just like one. And then each day, I just focus on that day now. I just so I could be more intentional and like, I don't know about y'all, but I love like doing, I just love the feeling of checking something off your list. Like it just gives me
I think it's
like
like a
all the
dopamine hack
satisfaction.
too.
Yeah. But I was getting really down because sometimes, you don't really know how your day is looking until you're at that day. And what I started noticing is I was just doing too much, like too much planning ahead.
Yeah,
And
like you've had these
now,
ongoing, infinitely never-ending to-do lists that you're working
yeah.
off of.
And you're like, girl, like, hold on, that didn't even happen that day. So just like relax, you know? And so I don't plan my days out until day of now, like morning of, just because I think when you're finally come to the day, now you can figure out, okay, well, these are like my top priorities, especially for work. And I'm the same with you now. I only have like five actual ones I really want to focus on, and those will be my main priority. But then if I have some time, I just go to the other task, the other task list. But I think approaching your day not filled with all of this stuff that you have to do is, like you said, you could just do a lot more. Do a lot more without like getting your nervous system all worked up because all these damn tasks.
And I'm glad you said that too, because like nervous system and body work, that is such a big core component of our healing, is that a lot of our automatic like trauma responses, they're subconscious because they exist in our nervous system. Like we have these auto responses when certain things come up, and we're like conditioned into those automated responses. But stillness and ease and rest and really learning to listen to ourselves and learning to listen to our bodies without getting so worked up in our minds is really the key to healing, honestly. So yeah, I think, okay, so another thing that I started to practice is I stopped saying yes to back-to-back meetings. So if I have a meeting that goes from 10 to 11, I will absolutely say no to another meeting at 11. And even beyond that now, especially because I always have a lot of administrative work to do and I do so much grant writing and, project-based work that requires my full attention, is that I'll max out at like two, maybe three meetings a day. Like if somebody tries to ask me another meeting after I already have three, always bad. I'm sorry, we're gonna have to push it out. And even further with meetings, okay, this is just about meetings in general. These are for folks who organize and who meet with a lot of other folks, is that I'm gonna give myself at least 1 to 2 weeks to schedule these meetings out. Like, don't ask me to schedule a meeting tomorrow unless it's super, super urgent. Like, if it's really that urgent, just call me real quick. You know what I mean? Like, and maybe we could talk about it, maybe if I'm available. But definitely giving ourselves a leeway of when we're scheduling things and giving more time and spaciousness in our schedule, I think is so important.
Yes. And that's another thing too of really just setting your boundaries and advocating for yourself. Because if they could be doing all these meetings, they could also accommodate, their guests as well. Okay. So do you think we should hop into what we do as an organization now?
Yes, but I just have a couple more. Just last three. Okay, so
Okay,
every day,
go ahead.
one thing I do every day is I give myself a deep work period where I put my phone on Do Not Disturb and I just like completely zone in and I don't worry about nothing else. And I make sure I'm, of course, I've eaten and I got my drink right here, but I'll set a deep work period for at like 2 hours. And during these 2 hours, I'm just making sure I'm like full throttle, zone in, completely focused on like what are my goals for the day. And a lot of times I notice that if I'm not worried and not distracted with any other things, I'm gonna get a good, like a majority of my tasks done in these like 2 hours. And one thing that helps me during that deep work period is a good playlist. Me personally, I like music with no words that are super upbeat or words that I don't understand what they're saying. Like I love Latin dance music, or I've started to play a lot more like house and techno where the words are super repetitive, so it's not too distracting. So music really helps me cultivating that productive vibe. And just the last thing I'll say too is like not too fully invest yourself only in your day job. Like I really think it's important for us to be able to pursue passions outside of our work and even additional income. Like think about how else we can make money doing something that we might enjoy, you know, so it doesn't all feel like work. And if you could put that into one thing where you're pursuing your passion and it be a passion that can generate you income, even better. So those are just the last kind of tips and tricks that I have that I think, you know, just gives us a sense of vitality in our work and in our life that for me personally has been super productive.
Yes, I loved everything that you said too, and I really want to highlight how important it is to also have or just invest your time in other passions, because what I've came to realize is that those other passions could feed a lot even into your day job too. You know, the strengths that you develop and the skills that you develop, like you could really help out even your day job to become better. So definitely do that. And like I said earlier, we are not our job titles. We're eventually not gonna work at the place that we've been investing our time in, you know? And when we hit that age, we're gonna just be ourselves. Just be us. So really invest your time in. And now definitely let's get into the work or org, what we do for our org. And I kind of wanted to speak on what you said earlier about the, for me, one of my top ones was how Bay Peace really just sets the vibe in our office. Like clean space, we have essential oil diffuser, we have incense, we have sage, we have big windows, like. And at the other time too is like when we're all working together, we always be having some type of music just to like keep us company while we work. And I feel like having that space to do good work is such a key thing that everybody should be putting into their jobs.
Yeah, we definitely have a beautiful workspace, even with all of the art and the decoration that we
Yes.
have everywhere. You know, the way our furniture is set up is super functional. We have like a little meditation corner now that y'all set up, and like keeping things organized. So yeah, definitely having a clean, organized, and inspiring workspace.
Yes, it's so beautiful. And this is for the when organizations, right? It's just whoever is, you know, a worker or a business owner or even teachers could take this in to, you know, their little note. And or if you or your job has like a suggestion box, you know, just write these tips down because we're about to unlock some other ones that we really love to do at Baby Show.
Yes, this is especially, yeah, especially for company or org leaders who are able to really implement this. It's really important for us as leaders to set the tone and like pave the way to make it possible for our people to thrive and to be well. And so making sure that we're able to support them and, create the space and set the work processes up in a way that'll allow them to do so. So I guess this is one of the big things that I feel like is super important is just that it shouldn't be only about employees working for companies, but I believe that businesses and organizations need to work for their employees too. You know what I mean? So making accommodations as they're needed and being understanding of personal needs or personal situations or life experiences that people are going through and being willing to be flexible for our people is so important, especially when we want our companies to grow, then individuals need to be well taken care of so that they would be willing to also grow with the companies. And I think having a great retention allows for greater growth because people are able to help see the transformation through.
Yes, absolutely. Like you could do so much if you just think just a little extra for, your workplace. Flipping through my notes, I also, oh, okay. So one of the things that I even have gotten feedback, and a lot of people have definitely mentioned this to us, is every time that we have, or okay, first off, having staff meetings are very much necessary. Okay. A job should not be having staff meetings like every 3 months because I've worked at a place like that. And staff meetings really just create a space for your employees and your boss to all get on the same page. And it's just really necessary. And I know like some folks really just don't like meetings, and I definitely feel you on that. But one thing that you can implement into your meetings is a check-in question. We always do check-in questions. And sometimes they're like deep, and then sometimes they're really just fun, and it's really a way just to just get their thoughts out and just talk to your people, And I really enjoy our check-ins all the time. Even if I go into the office, either Sin and or Sam and I, we do a check-in, and it's just a way just to talk about something that isn't just work real quick,
Yeah, being able to connect personally, I think, is really important, and realizing that even outside the work, we're people and humans who are having real experiences outside of this. So I like being able to connect with everybody personally. So I'm with you. I can't believe you go 3 months without a staff meeting. Like, that's crazy to me.
It
Anyways.
was crazy to me. It was psychotic to me, actually.
Yes, I could never. Anyways, we could never. Okay, so let's see. One thing that I think Bay Peace does a really great job at, that we do a really good job at, is collaborative decision making. And so me as a boss, I never make big decisions that would require commitments and work from the collective without first checking in with y'all and making sure that we talk about it as a group. And we're mindful of capacity. I always double triple check with y'all, like, are you sure? It might be something you want to do, but is it something that you have capacity to do? Is it necessary? Is it urgent? Is it something that could wait? And yeah, making sure we're checking with each other on the things that we're committing to as an organization or that we have to commit to as individuals.
Yes, I love it. And it's so key just because we do so much and there's so many dimensions into our work, And just having that time and thinking about and having just really just having that communication is needed just because a lot of things could just get under beneath the surface and we'll just forget all about it because we just do so much. But having that communication and everybody having that communication, not just the boss or the employees, but everyone has
Right.
that equal communication.
Exactly.
Oh, okay. Another thing with that is Lay started doing one-on-one check-ins with us, and I love that time just to sit down with Lay and we talk about personal development and professional development, and we also combine a little wellness in there as well. And I don't know anybody who does that, but I really just love it just because I feel so empowered and heard after. Basically, Lay's like my mentor in those meetings, and she's really just there to help me out and for me to just say anything I need or I want to say, and solution based as well, not just like complaining or anything like that. It's just how can we, how can we make it a little better sometimes? Or if it's wellness, Lay checks in with my wellness and just how I'm doing. I really loved how we implemented those things.
Yeah, I love those too. I look forward to those times, and I'm glad you enjoy those. That was definitely, one of my big intentions with those is to just devote time and attention and energy to y'all's growth as individuals. So I'm glad it's working out that way. And another thing that I personally really appreciate that existed even before I came into the organization is our 32-hour work weeks. And the society is catching on. There's a lot of organizations that are starting to incorporate this into their work practices, but having these shorter work weeks just, man, have allowed me the spaciousness and time that I need to like tend to my family and tend to my wellness and even pursue opportunities outside of work. Of course, there are challenges sometimes, but I think, we've been flexible about what our hours are for these 32-hour work weeks. And it also allows folks to like get off early if we need to, or have shorter days on Fridays, or not work on Fridays, whatever the situation is. So, having shorter work weeks has been amazing. And it's also helped with our organization as well, because it's like you don't have to pay overtime unless it's. We're not obligated to pay overtime legally, right? Unless it's over 40 hours. And so, sometimes we'll have that cushion for folks to be able to work more than 32 hours if we needed them to, but it protects us as an organization financially as well.
And this is my last one, but we unintentionally started just kicking it with each other, like as a team, and doing things and going out and having fun that doesn't have to do anything with work. Like we know each other on a personal level, we know each other in work. And just creating that relationship just to cultivate joy and having fun, I love, and I think a lot of people I know gain friends within their workspace and their coworkers, and just having that time is so key and just so fun, and we could laugh and just do all that thing and then get back to work right on Monday.
Yes. Let's see. Okay, another one is our seasonal shutdowns. I love our shutdown.
Seasonal shutdown.
So we usually do one every other season. Typically we have our summer shutdown, but we've been kind of flexible these past couple years and just deciding as a collective like what works for our staff, given our program schedules and given our personal schedules. But I think having at least those two seasonal shutdowns is helpful, especially in between when work periods get super busy. So in the winter, we shut down during Christmas and New Year's weeks. And then we also shut down for 1 week in the summertime. And these are paid shutdowns.
Yes. I love that.
Yes, these are
That
super necessary,
was
super needed. Yeah, do you have any other ones you want to talk about before I say this last one?
I do have one, but I feel like it might be what you have, so I'm gonna let you go.
Okay, is it the wellness stipends?
Yes, it was.
Yeah, like you said, y'all being able to advocate for raises or, get more money to sustain your expenses and your living is so important. But sometimes, as organizations, we can't always keep up with the rising market rates. But what we have been able to do is sustain monthly stipends at the same rate for all of our employees. And it's just more income on top of your hourly rates or salary rates to support your wellness. And you're able to spend it however you see fit. And this is one way for organizations to, better sustain their budgets, but also support the financial wellness of like your employees. So having those additional stipends devoted to folks' wellness. I also know some organizations that for folks who use their own computers or their own phones for work, they also offer like device stipends or device reimbursement. So those are things that can be helpful too, but just an additional supplemental income on top of their normal salary is really helpful because we need money to make things work.
To make money.
So yeah, I hope folks took notes. Org leaders, remember you have a responsibility to set the tone. And if folks are ever interested, I'm more than happy to check in and talk about, more of the struggles and challenges and how we really made these things real within our organization. And I highly encourage folks on the personal level to devote time and attention every single day and every single moment to making sure you are well.
Absolutely. Show up, be your best self, and also just tend to yourself as well.
Absolutely. All right.
Yes, y'all. Well, that
Well,
concludes
that's
it.
it. That concludes our Wellness Centered Work Culture episode for Free Our Mind Friday. So go on and get liberated.
Yes, and have a beautiful, beautiful October.
Peace, y'all.
Bye.